We're going back in time, counting down the top 80 songs from the greatest pop music decade in the history of human civilization, the 1980s. You're listening to the 80 of the 80s podcast with your hosts, DJ CK1 and AK47.
I work hard for my money.
Yeah?
So hard for it, honey. Mm-hmm. You better treat me right.
You work
two jobs.
Part-time jobs.
But it's two jobs.
It is?
Yes. Yeah. And I don't really work that hard.
No, I'm grateful for everything you do.
Because I'm working a lot, it's your job to... You have to lead the show and you have to edit it as well. Because I just don't have the time.
Got it.
I'm bringing home the bacon and the bread.
I don't eat bacon.
And the butter.
Okay, I do eat butter.
Yeah, and the bullets.
And the, no.
Yeah, because you're AK-47.
Yes, I am AK-47. That is true.
And we need to keep you well stocked and supplied.
I need some ammo.
Yes, with your ammo.
Do you know what my ammo is?
Love?
Aw.
Why? No, what is your ammo?
Asparagus. Asparagus. I was trying to think of one of my favorite things, and I guess it would be video games and asparagus. Anyway, yeah, I'm AK-47.
And I'm CK-1, a fragrance by Calvin Klein. Mm-hmm. Here we are, counting down the best songs from the best decade. We started at 80, we're down to number 47. But before we announce what the 47th song is, we need to consult with the Gobotron 2000. We're back in his good graces again.
We hope so.
Yes, if you listeners remember... In our last show, we told him to screw himself, but we did that because, well, I guess since he's a robot, he would need a screwdriver to do that.
Yeah, it's a little difficult.
But we told him to do that because the episode before, he told us to screw ourselves. And so, you know, we were on bad terms. He has a chip on his metal hydraulics, but I think we sorted it all out. So he said that he will give us a secret word, but he wants you to be the button pusher.
Me. I'm the only one who can touch him.
Okay, well, the word is country.
Country?
Yes, so that can mean a few different things. Like, it can mean, like, a nation.
Yeah.
Right? A part of the world. Or it could also be the worst music genre ever.
Yep.
Maybe still being a little bit of a jerk, I
Maybe
guess.
Maybe so.
Giving us this.
Yeah, we're not going to discuss
Country music. Number 47 is...
Donna Summer.
And the
song
is...
This Time I Know It's Real. Sorry, people. Not one of my favorite songs. Surprisingly, right?
Surprisingly?
Well, I tend to not really care a whole lot for the choices that you, the board, chooses.
Yeah, but I work hard for my money, so you got to go along with this.
No, I don't.
You owe me something in this life, in this world. I'm a little surprised because you're a Stock Aitken Waterman fan, right?
Somewhat. Somewhat. I like Rick Astley. Bananarama's okay.
Yeah, and you could just take out her voice, put in Rick's voice, and would you like this song better
if it had Rick? The song is okay. If it's on the radio, I never ever think to just pause and turn it up full blast ever. The only time I'm ever like, it's okay if you're listening to it, I'm like, that's okay song, but I never seek it out.
That's okay.
It's kind of like dried herbs. They're okay, but fresh is fantastic. Does that make any sense? Probably.
You're
not
comparing Donna Summer to dried herbs.
Well, yeah, I just need to listen more to more of her stuff. I don't know.
Is it her voice?
I mean, she's a little chipmunky for me.
Chipmunky?
Mm-hmm.
She has a full, rich voice.
Maybe so.
I think, okay, this is maybe what...
Yeah, you got to edit that out, because you're right. Now that I'm thinking about it, she does.
I think you had a good reason to think that.
For me, it's more of a feeling. I just don't care a lot for most of her songs, so I ain't feeling it.
She does have a diverse voice. Maybe you're thinking about towards the beginning of her career, like some of her early hits.
Yes.
Love to Love You Baby.
I do.
I remember when.
Yeah.
The Love Trilogy song. She sings in a higher voice.
Yes, kind of whiny.
Love to Love You Baby, she said in order to get sexy, the best she could do is imagine that she was Marilyn Monroe. And she had to lie on the floor singing that with the lights out and just pretend like no one was listening to her. And she was thinking that that was going to be a demo, and it ended up being, you know, everyone heard it and her parents heard it and they were horrified and stuff, because she came from a really conservative Christian background. And actually, she remained a conservative Christian for pretty much her whole life. She was kind of seen as a sex symbol. She'd throw in some moanings and spoken word things and innuendos here and there. But she had a come to Jesus moment about 1980. And then she's like, okay, I'm going to maybe tone down the sex a little bit. And every album, I'm going to write a song about Jesus. And that helped her out.
Good for her.
Kept her from a nervous breakdown.
I'm more of a winter person than a summer person. Mm-hmm. So maybe that has something to do with it.
Yeah, she got her name from, she married a German guy.
Well, good for her. Okay, brownie points. Let's keep talking.
Well, she lived in Germany. She did off-Broadway shows in Germany, Hair and Godspell. And so she learned the language fluently. And during the 70s, she was married to a guy. His last name was Somer, S-O-M-E-R. And so she changed it to Summer.
Okay, I didn't know that. That's interesting.
And she has a concept album about the season. So maybe you would like the winter.
Maybe.
How about the autumn? The autumn changes song. Yeah.
Maybe I just need to give her more of a chance.
Right.
Because, you were right. When I think of her, I do think of her earlier stuff. And for me, it's very, I don't know if chipmunky was the right word. Mm-hmm. Maybe whiny. Kind of shrill, like loud. For me, anyway. Yeah. So, I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong about her. Let's continue with the podcast. No. Maybe it'll open my eyes a little bit.
Okay, actually, I prefer her 70s disco era over her 80s dance pop. And I'll use this word a lot. Iconic. Giorgio Moroder and Pete Berlot, I think is his name. They were kind of at the forefront of Euro disco, which the Euro disco thing influenced the American disco. So even though she's an American singer, she was actually more popular in Europe at the time, and it was considered more of a European sound. But you still have like the real strings, the real violins. I'm saying real because later all this stuff, all this Euro disco stuff became heavily synthesized in the 80s. You have lots of hi-hats on the cymbals, funky bass. I dig that genre's music. It makes me feel warm and happy, and I can understand how like it was heavy cocaine snorting music back in the day.
Yeah.
That kind of went along with the scene. I can understand the whole appeal of that. But I just think for a lot of disco music, I don't think the songwriting was as good as later it became in the 80s. Some of it was a bit long-winded and excessive. A lot of Giorgio Moroder songs, for example, her song Come With Me, which is a good song, but she repeats the phrase come with me like 20, 30, 50 times in the song, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, okay, we get it. Come with me. So that's the good and the bad of it. But I think three of my favorite songs that she does on the radio, she's got a lot of emotion in her voice in that song. It's kind of a sad but warm. Like she's singing out to a man. Probably one of her best vocal performances, I think. Very dynamic. Also, I like Heaven Knows.
Down inside. Don't get caught with foolish pride.
It had real horns in it, not the crappy synth horns. And
I thought you liked synth horns.
They're okay. I'm kind of... We discussed that last episode. I have mixed feelings about them, but I just love the interlude of Heaven Knows. They have... When the horn lines punch in. I guess albums were more expensive back then to produce because you had all these real skilled musicians in them. Again, let's say synthesizer musicians aren't real musicians. They're just, it's a whole different set of talent, I think.
Yeah, it is.
Oh, yeah, Heaven Can Wait. It was a duet with...
Heaven Knows.
Heaven Knows. It's a duet with Joe Esposito.
Oh, I know that name.
He's probably best known for the Karate Kid soundtrack.
That's right.
Yeah. You're the best around.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Joe Bean Esposito. He was in a singing trio named Brooklyn Dreams, and Donna later married a member of Brooklyn Dreams. After she divorced Mr. Somar, she married a guy who was in this Brooklyn Dreams trio. The third one is Last Dance, which probably one of her most famous songs. I mean, I think it's one of the songs that lives up to the hype.
Really?
Yes. I'm sure everyone's heard it before and knows why it's a great song.
See, to me, again, it's one of those songs that if you're listening to it, I think, oh, it's okay.
Right.
But I would never stop the radio station you would never start to dancing. Listen yeah. to it.
Right.
I don't dance to anything. But it's not a song that I would seek out to listen to. I just wouldn't. And so maybe it's just not my thing. But
you have to admire her vocal performance.
I do. Now that you're speaking more about it and I'm thinking of different songs of hers, yeah, I guess I was wrong to say she was Chipmunky. But,
well,
you know, she's talented.
And also in defense of your chipmunk comment.
Hey, I like chipmunks. Let's not.
But you don't like Kylie Minogue, right?
I don't like Kylie Minogue. No, I don't.
Stock and Aiken, they do the music, and Waterman, he's the manager. But that was their favorite album that they ever did, was the one they did with Donna Summer.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it had the most potential. Well, Rick Astley has a great voice, too.
Oh, Rick Astley. You can't beat him.
I don't know. I think Donna is just the talent and the skill. She had 15, at least, years of studio
experience. Yeah.
And everything. And so she nailed it. It's just that the songwriting just sounds like songs that were written for Kylie Minogue. It kind of limits the range.
It doesn't give her enough to play with.
Right.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
Doesn't give
I get her what you're saying.
Yes.
Yeah, but I think it's more of a nasally, like Kylie Minogue is kind of nasally sounding.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And I'm a little bit of a hypocrite because as we're sitting here, I'm thinking of a few artists that sound kind of nasally that I like. So again, for me, it's all about feeling. Kylie Minogue, nope.
Yep.
Nope.
Yep.
Nope.
Well, I want to give a little bit of a spoiler.
Here we go.
No, our listeners can guess. I do agree. All of Stock, Aiken, Waterman produced stuff all sounds very similar.
It does, yeah.
I can only listen to so much of it at a time, but taken individually, there are some awesome, incredible dance pop songs. There is a reason why there's so many of them were huge hits, especially in Britain.
Mm-hmm.
There are going to be three other artists in our top 80 countdown that are Stock Aiken Waterman artists or songs that were produced by them.
One of them, I must say, I'm very excited about.
Right, okay. Yes.
But I would imagine that's going to be pretty far down there, right?
Well, we have to wait and see.
Oh, it better be. We're going to brawl. And I'm still waiting for Kraftwerk, by the way.
Can we just go one show without mentioning?
I have my newly framed Kraftwerk picture.
You're looking at it right now in our studio.
Right in front of me. And
yes.
I have my autograph up there. And
your Kraftwerk 3D
little,
glasses.
My little collage up there.
Yeah.
And I just, every time we record, I think, is it going to be Kraftwerk? Is it going to be Kraftwerk? And it never is. So that just means it's got to be top 10. I just know it. I can feel it.
Again, hold you guys in suspense, okay? Because I know this is the most important countdown of your life. It's like, never mind the president.
Who's
going to be
that?
Who's going to be president 2020?
Probably Britney Spears. No, I want to talk about the video. We watched it before we started recording. I have seen it before, but I just wanted a little bit of a refresher. And that video makes me feel like I'm going to pass out. If you are an epileptic, I really recommend staying away from that video because it goes so fast.
Yeah.
It really moves very, very quickly.
Well, it matches the sound because it's a very high energy dance song. Very,
it is,
yes.
But it's almost too much. But she kind of looked like she was about to break into some weird country line dance.
Ah!
Oh, there you go!
Yes!
I said it!
The girl, okay. He knows. This is scary. He can predict the future like that.
That's really crazy. That was totally unplanned. But no, it does. It kind of looked
boots.
Like Yeah, and the little skirt, like the mm-hmm. Dixie Stampede skirt.
She was cute.
I thought it was weird, but hey, to each their own.
And then they have like these really cheesy dancers who are like running in place.
Yeah, I guess it looks like there's some strong wind blowing at them, but there's no wind.
I think it has a little bit of a train theme, like we're riding on the train across the ocean.
Well, yeah, because she's traveling around the world, I think was the point of the video. They're showing the map where she's traveling to different locations because she's talking about, I guess, how awesome she is. Is that what this is?
She needs to let this guy know that it's for real.
That she's in love with him or something, so right. She's trying to hunt him down.
Yes.
Maybe that's it. I don't know. But it still moves. It moved away too quickly.
So, should I write or call your home?
Dude, email him.
Shout it out with a megaphone. Shout it out with a megaphone. Shout out with megaphone. Like, kind of think about this. Radio, TV, news. She's going to get on the news.
I know. Hey, don't knock it, man. TransX wrote a song about it. The message on the radio.
I think she's Donna Summer. So, it would make sense that she could say it over on the radio. Whoa. But then she's like talking about like a tightrope. Okay, walk a tightrope way up high, write your name across the sky. That's how she's going to let a guy know that she's into him. This is I think the typical male versus female thing. Women, they want some romantic shaving onto a cow, the side of a cow, and have the cow run out into the field, say marry me or something. Balloons. Yeah. Women always like balloon proposals or something on during a football game.
Here's the thing that men don't understand. Men always whine and complain about why do women want romance, yada yada this. Yeah. If you want to get some, you better be romantic. It's just the way it is. You know, and men don't understand it, okay? It's totally fine. You don't have to understand it. Just do it and you will be rewarded. I promise, okay?
Right.
It's just the way women function. We like to know that we're valued and appreciated and loved. And that's just, you know, I don't consider myself a girly girl necessarily, but even I like romance. So that's a whole other podcast.
Yeah, no, I mean, I've heard the quote, the truth. A man who says he knows what a woman's thinking is a man who knows nothing.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
So, men and women were just very different.
Right.
And that's all I'm saying. If you want to get you some, shave a cow. Go ahead.
If you haven't learned anything from the show.
Yes.
Shave a cow. So when I heard the song back in 89, I instantly loved it. And it was one of the songs I waited on the radio to hear the stereo drum effect. It's kind of like the exactly same thing as Rick Astley's Never Gonna Give You Up.
Yes. That song we can talk about all night long.
Right, but we're talking about this song.
I know.
You know, I came on there and pressed record. I'm like, yes, yes. So then my good friend, we were talking about songs that we like on the radio because back in the day, they would actually play good songs on the radio that we could talk about.
Yeah.
And I told him to say, oh, I really like you know, This Time I Know It's For Real. He said, oh, it's that Shout It Out with the Megaphone song. Shout it out with a megaphone. Yeah, it's kind of cheesy and silly, but hey, it's a really catchy song.
I like
and
cheesy songs.
Well, it's just, I was listening to Bad Girls.
Yeah, I know that song.
Yeah, her album Bad Girls, because the transformation from disco to new wave pop, I'm trying to find some median where it morphs from one side to the next, but it doesn't. Like on Bad Girls, it's a four-sided album. So one side's rock and roll, one side's old ballads, and one side's traditional disco, and then one side is the sequencers and synths like that's on I Feel Love. There's nothing in between. So a lot of people say like the Stock Aitken Waterman and Italo disco thing that went on the 80s. It is descended from the 70s string-laden funky disco that most Americans associate with disco. There's a relation there. But the lineage, there's just the break. Like right in the year, easily enough, like the year 1980, suddenly there's a break. And it goes from disco to synth pop, just like that. I think it's just because disco, it was so prevalent. I mean, we're talking about 2/3 of all records produced one year. I think it was 78 or something were disco records, to when there was such a huge backlash to it and the fad burned out so quickly. But people still wanted to dance to something that they had to change the sound of it drastically enough to where people wouldn't think of, oh, this is disco.
I like some disco. I'm not a huge, huge disco fan, but there's like Italian disco's, you know, pretty good.
But see, I still think of that as like synth pop.
Yeah, that's true. I can see that.
Right. So why don't we take a commercial break?
Let's move on to something else.
Take a commercial break?
Yes.
So you have to say the thing, you know.
Okay. 80 of the 80s. We'll be right back.
Have you ever wanted to be rich, be popular, live forever? Well, we can't help you with any of that, but we can help you own and maintain a classic pinball machine like a boss. Trust us. We have no idea what we're doing. The Lock Is Lit podcast with Rick and Mark. Pinball podcast for idiots, by idiots.
Thank you for filling out the surveys.
Yes, I want to thank all of our listeners who took part in our survey campaign. We are going to keep recording these podcasts because we want to spread the good word about the great music of the 1980s.
Yeah.
Drugs? No way, no ways, no why.
Don't touch drugs. Don't ever touch drugs. Ever.
I'm no dope. I say no.
I've been asked. You know what I say?
Drugs? Not on my life.
Users are losers, and losers are users. So don't use drugs. Don't use drugs. Winners don't use, and users don't win. So don't use drugs. Don't use drugs. If you know a user even part of the time,
tell him to quit. Take a bite out of crime.
Users are losers, and losers are users, so don't use drugs.
Hi-ho, this is CK1 here. During the 1980s, Donna Summer recorded 7 albums, and they're quality listens, so here's a countdown of my 5 favorite. But you don't have to take my word for it. Number 5. 1984's Cats Without Claws was a stylistic follow-up to her mega-popular album She Works Hard for the Money from the year before. Here's she and her co-writer and husband, Bruce Sedano, and producer Michael O'Martin fail to reformulate any noteworthy hits. There are, however, some fun synth bangers, like this lead-off, Supernatural Love. Similar to what Laura Branigan and the Pointer Sisters were doing at the time. You gotta love that robo voice. I miss that trend. Number 4. No doubt, This Time I Know Is For Real was the standout from 89's Another Place and Time. While the other songs are not as memorable as those other Stock, Aitken, and Waterman produced albums, like those by Rick and Kylie, there are a few standout moments, like Love's About to Change My Heart, which starts slow and builds to a climax that actually utilizes the full strength of her voice. It's a welcome throwback to her classic disco days. Number 3. Yeah, the title track to 83's She Works Hard for the Money was a bit overplayed, but listen to the rest of the album and you'll find some other punchy ditties, like People, People. Perfect for your aerobic workout mixtape. Number 2. In
1980, Donna signed with David Geffen. A few years later, he hooked her up with producer Quincy Jones. Likewise, her self-titled album is the closest you'll get to another Michael Jackson Thriller. In addition, Love Is Just a Breath Away teams her up with heatwave keyboardist and hit Michael Jackson songwriter Rod Temperton. Number 1. But it was in 81 that Donna recorded a few dozen songs with Giorgio Moroder. David Geffen despised them so much that he scrapped the entire effort and disbanded the iconic Summer Moroder partnership. It was 15 years before this double album titled I'm a Rainbow was finally released. It was much to the joy of Donna Summer fans. I'm a Rainbow was not another disco album, but a full-fledged barrage of pulsating new wave synth pop. Like this tune, Melanie. Geffen couldn't hear it at the time, but Moroder was ahead of the curve. I'd also like to mention one more tune that Geffen unjustly trashed. All the waiting, all the praying, write the answer to all of the love we've been saving. Lyrics rarely make a song, but they can add to its appeal. Songs about children were once much too sappy for my taste. But now that I'm a father, I can appreciate the sentiment of Brooklyn, a song Donna wrote about her newborn daughter. I now think it's nice to hear a pop star sing about something other than boy-girl romance, for a change. Daddy felt you for him, saw you, mommy, carried you so long. Mimi saw you for she, felt you, the four is a family so strong.
Oh my gosh, we have an amazing concert coming up, and I'm so excited.
Yes. As we announced in our last show, we are going to experience the Tears, Four Fears, and the Hall, and the Oats.
Yay!
At the same time.
It's very exciting.
Yes.
Very, very exciting.
Not at the same time, but same concert.
Yeah.
I wonder how long does the concert will be. So.
I don't know. I don't care. I'll sit there all
but
night.
Maybe on our next show we'll do a report on it on
yes,
how it went.
Of course
so,
we will.
Right.
Yes.
Heist music.
This may seem completely irrelevant to an 80s podcast, but there is a point to this, I promise. I went to the movies with your mom to see the Beauty and the Beast movie, which I am not a musical fan. The movie was okay, though. Anyway, my point is, in the previews, the Despicable Me 3 trailer, okay, I am not a fan of that series at all. However, the villain in this movie is like some 80s mastermind.
Some kind of monster.
Wait, that's not a monster. That's a man wearing shoulder pads. There's only one supervillain whose fashion sense is quite that dated.
Have you seen this?
I saw one of the trailers.
It had me laughing so hard.
Yeah.
I thought, okay, I'm going to have to see this movie now.
Yeah.
Now I feel like I have to watch the first two because I'm going to be missing out on something. Mm-hmm. But it looked so funny.
Yeah, he's got the guitar, the
yes.
mullet.
And he's chewing the gum and then he blows bubbles with the gum as like a weapon.
Yeah.
And then he moonwalks and stuff. It's just brilliant.
Right, right.
It's just brilliant. I love it.
I've said this before, but it's sad that decades anymore, they don't really have as much of an identity.
Yeah.
Maybe we're still too close to the last couple decades.
No, I think you're right about that, though, because I think about the year 2000 to the year 2010, and I think from that decade to from 2010 to now, you can't really tell a difference.
Right.
I don't think so. Maybe it's just because I'm getting older.
Yeah.
But I can't really tell a difference. I mean, everyone dresses the same. Everybody, music sounds kind of similar. I don't know.
Yeah. So that decade, the zeros, the noughts.
Yeah, whatever
the
they call it. I don't even know what they call it. Yeah.
The O's, 2000 through 2010, No way, actually, it'd be 2000, 2009.
Yeah, I guess you're right. Yeah.
I've read a discussion, some people on the internet said that there was nothing good about that decade. Mm-hmm. And so, I tell you what, our listeners, why don't you, if there's something decent about that decade that you want to mention, something good, that something that stands out, something that identifies that decade, we're talking about the 2000s,
Well,
something you're nostalgic about that you miss, just send us an email, 80ofthe80s@gmail.com.
That's, yeah, I would be curious. Yeah. I mean, there's some like 90s bands I can think of that had some decent stuff, like my favorite band, Oasis, but right. That's not 80s, so we won't go into that. But yeah, I can't really think of a whole lot outside of that. I mean, really, what the hell happened? I don't know. Yeah, let us know. I'm curious what you guys have to say. Surely I'm forgetting something awesome. Right. I don't know.
You can also record an audio file, email that to us as well. 80ofthe80s@gmail.com. 80ofthe80s@gmail.com.
Good for you.
Yes. And wow. Yeah, let us know.
I want to be near you, baby.
There are always some, you know, 80s related bands every now and then will come out with a new album. So there, you know, some of them are still kicking it.
Yeah.
Like Erasure. I have not listened. I've only listened to the single for Erasure, the new Erasure album. And it's decent, a little catchy. I don't know. It didn't really knock my socks off, but.
No, I can confirm that it didn't.
No, okay. I love you to the sky, 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 sky. I'm not telling you lies, 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 lies. You can be my summer romance. Say it's not an omen. Tell me that you want me. I love you to the sky, 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 sky. Every time I always hope there's going to be this another great Erasure album, and they've always come out being kind of
a little bit of a letdown.
Erasure, almost all their songs sound the same, and then that's fine because I still love them and I love that sound. Just some of their songwriting is better than others, and I just don't think the songwriting from the recent albums it hasn't stood out as much. But maybe there's hope for this new one, and I can't remember the name of the new album, but I think it's already out in stores. Also, now, Goldfrapp is not an 80s group.
No, they aren't.
But they've had some albums like Supernature, Head First, Black Cherry that did have very much an 80s sound. There's that side of Goldfrapp. There's the other side of Goldfrapp where they do atmospheric wistful music and things of that
sort. I'll allow Goldfrapp because I like them, but none of that Chiverches stuff.
Okay. Remember DJ Sirius?
I do.
Yeah, he was the guy who used to do the Japanese segments.
Whatever happened to that dude, man? He's an awesome dude.
When actually, you know, he just sent me a text message that he said that the new Goldfrapp album, Silver Eye, he says it's good. The sound quality is great. You can tell that Allison Goldfrapp, is getting older, but she still sounds good. Really, the album seems like a cross between Supernature and Head First. Yeah, the synth dance sound. Though not sure if the songwriting is as good as previous albums. Synths are powerful, but understated at the same time. Interesting paradox.
So it sounds like it's worth a listen. That's
yeah.
For sure.
Yeah. So yeah, check out the Goldfrapp.
Yeah.
The music video was really disturbing, but often Goldfrapp videos are. All right.
Okay, so we screwed up, or should I say you screwed up?
Yes.
Last podcast number 48, OMD. You made a few boo-boos, is that right?
Well, and in my defense, the Gobotron, he was angry with us, so he didn't correct him. So
but
I was.
You've just gotten to where you lean on him too much.
Right, I know. And so I got lazy. So I need to apologize to our listeners for these factual errors from show number 48. First off, the name of the main guy from Pretty in Pink, the Andrew
McCarthy?
Yeah, the Andrew McCarthy character. It's mm-hmm. Blaine.
Blaine!
Blaine, right.
That is right.
Who in the hell is named Blaine? Have you ever met a Blaine in real life?
Not in real life, no, I haven't.
It's kind of a bland name, if you ask me. Next, I said...
Hey, don't say that. Somebody who's listening, their name might be Blaine.
Sorry, Blaine.
Actually, honestly, I'm not just saying this because of that. I think it's kind of a cool name, but I've just never met anybody with it before, so...
I said that the DeLorean is 25 years ahead of its time. I really should have said 35 years.
Oh my God, no way.
Yes, because that's how old, the car is at least that old. Wow. So, when I played the Depeche Mode song Fail, I said that the lyric was, you failed, but actually it was kind of embarrassing because right after I said you failed, then we heard Martin Gore singing, we failed.
Yeah,
so that is true. Yeah, that was a mistake. The name of the the name of the vocalist for Warlock, her name is Doro Pesch.
Well, I knew that.
Yeah. You should have told me what her name was. Yes, one of the most attractive women of rock and roll.
Yeah,
she's. And then finally, the OMD song is, I said that the song was Telegram, but it's actually Telegraph.
Yeah.
Telegraph.
Oh, I'm sorry. I knew that. I thought I should have corrected you.
Yeah, you should have.
I was in OMD world. You let me down. I wasn't even listening to
you. Let me down.
Sorry.
Well, we learned to listen.
Was Telegraph. That's the video where he gets all dancey like George McFly.
Yes.
Oh, it's adorable. Oh my God, it's adorable.
Right.
Crispin Glover, I love him.
Yeah, who was the other dancer you said you liked?
I love him. There's Crispin Glover, Andy McCluskey, and
there was someone else.
Rick Astley kind of dances like.
Yeah, he
sexy
does.
And
but
stuff.
There was someone else who's doing the sexy
Ian
dance.
Ian Curtis.
No, yeah, you mentioned him, but there was a.
There's a lot of people I think do kind of weird sexy dances. But George McFly is, I mean, that's just epic.
Yeah.
It's epic. Well, you kind of dance like that too. You kind of do the fist, weird, awkward, standing in the corner type thing.
Yeah.
It's really hot. Yeah.
I know. And that's, I don't know why. I never picked up more women back in the day when I used to hit the clubs.
That's so. Because you never hit the clubs.
Well, I did.
Maybe once.
I was lonely in the city of Birmingham, Alabama. And I actually tried going to some dance clubs by myself. And that was pathetic and.
No, it's not.
Sad and pathetic. And,
yeah. It is not sad and pathetic. I don't think they do this anymore. But when I was a kid, when you would walk down the streets in Nashville, like they would blare country music out of the speakers. You couldn't get away from it, okay? Yeah. When I was a kid, that was the way it was. Mm-hmm. So I just grew up hating country music. Like, absolutely hating it. That is the reason why I despise country music. Now, I respect it. There's a difference. I mean, I do respect it because I know a lot of the background and stuff from a lot of these artists, but a fan of the sound? No.
Because a lot of times the music that people grow up to, they become, at the very least, desensitized to it where it doesn't bother them as much.
Yeah.
And a lot of people get to like it. The music that they're raised with is the music that they feel in their blood.
Yeah.
It's woven into their DNA.
I think, and this is totally my opinion here, but I think there are leaders and there are followers. And yeah. I think most people tend to be followers. There's nothing wrong with that. If it makes you happy, then that's awesome. But I was always the one who was different, and I didn't mean to be. I just kind of was.
Yeah.
I didn't, and I think that stems a lot from my mother because she was like that. My mom liked what she liked. She didn't give a crap. I don't know, but you're right. Most of my friends listened to, a lot of my friends listened to country music and stuff like that, but. You know, it's different now. A lot of hipsters have moved into Nashville. And again, I'm not knocking the hipsters either. They made my mom's property value skyrocket, like quadruple or something crazy. But anyway, to each their own. How many times have I said that? This podcast, yes. Like 70,000?
Actually, I think that should be the theme.
That should be the theme.
Of the
that,
whole
but,
show.
But you know, that really is the theme. That's one of my main thoughts is just... You don't like somebody, just shut the hell up. If they're not hurting you, why do you give a crap, you know?
Yeah.
Everybody has their own thing. But at the same time, I think everybody has the right to express their opinion about things. So,
my mother and father, they had Donna Summer Live, the double album.
Cool, I didn't know that.
Yes.
Yeah.
On vinyl.
I can see your dad totally digging Donna Summer.
Well, you know, they had the album, but I don't really remember them ever listening to it. But some of the songs on it did sound kind of familiar. And so maybe that is why I still have a taste for her. I also remember parents like Neil Diamond and Barry Manilow.
Yeah.
And I can still appreciate some of that stuff. So
yeah, my mom listened to all that too.
Yeah, so maybe...
Maybe that's why I'm more tolerant of it.
My mom's favorite.
Of the
favorite.
Soft rock sounds that became so uncool.
But I think that's important, and I hope that, that parents these days are doing that, introducing their children to all types of music, because, I mean, I couldn't get away from country. So I was going to be introduced to it regardless, but my mom, like, her favorite artists were The Beatles, Metallica, Edith Piaf.
And I think it's more than maybe just being raised that way. I think it's just, I think it's in our genes. I think it's we genetically inherited the appreciation for high quality pop music. I know
maybe
high quality
so.
And pop don't always go together unless you're talking about the Boston Pops.
Yeah.
But I say it does.
Right. We hope you enjoyed the 80 of the 80s podcast, a proud member of the Throwback Network. To support our show, please leave review at iTunes. You can also download more episodes at TuneIn, Stitcher, or on our website, 80ofthe80s.com. And we also want to be your Facebook friend. Until the next song, this is AK-47 thanking you for your power play. Peace in the Middle East.
Yay.
I had to say that just one time.
Why?
I don't know, because I used to say it when I was like 10.
And we still want peace in the Middle East all this time.
We still need it.
That phrase
peace
will never
in the
go.
Middle East.
It's like you could buy, that's like the one bumper sticker.
I know,
that
never.
You'll never have to replace.
It'll just fade out and you'll just keep putting new ones over and you'll have this big, thick stack of stickers.
Right.
That's so sad. I'm not meaning to laugh about it. It's really sad.